Blackstone Audio presents Unlikely Warrior, A Jewish Soldier in Hitler's Army by Georg Rauch, translated by Phyllis Rauch. This book is read by Robert Fass. To Phyllis, for steering me away from mediocrity and sharing 40 years of dreams. Foreword. In 1984, exactly 40 years after my husband's Russian experience, he began writing this memoir. A chance event led to Georg's opening the letters that he had written to his mother all those years before. Soon thereafter, Georg left his art studio, a rare event, and began to write. He wrote 7 days a week, by hand on yellow legal pads, and read each day's pages to me as we sat on the terrace of our home in Mexico, overlooking Lake Chapala, every afternoon. The next day, I translated them into English. Georg was a total extrovert who loved to laugh and joke. He was a tireless raconteur and easily the center of attention at most social gatherings. Some of his war experiences also figured in his dinner party stories. I had heard the tale related in the early chapter, The Hardest Thing, a number of times before. But the afternoon he read this part of the book aloud to me on the terrace, he began to sob. It may have been the only time I ever saw him cry. Obviously, the 10 years he spent after the war creating expressionist paintings featuring sad men, clowns, and harlequins had not quite achieved the cathartic results he had believed. There were still memories, as well as feelings of grief, shame, guilt, and despair to be confronted and dealt with, this time not on a canvas, but in words. Only in retrospect do I understand that Georg's intense days of writing were not just another example of his disciplined nature. He had to get it out, and he had to get it over with. Had I understood this more fully, I might not have chafed so much under his constant demands to see the English translation. Although I am fluent in German, I purchased 2 fat German dictionaries in order to deal with a completely new vocabulary, words about battles and weapons, uniforms and ranks. It was slogging, intense work, and sometimes we quarreled when he told me I wasn't translating fast enough. Now, more than 30 years later, I understand much better what was fueling his demands. Georg sometimes gave an additional explanation for why he wrote the book. Many of his art collectors were Jewish. When we met these people, conversations often led to Georg's history. He sensed that some people were perplexed, or worse, when they heard that he had been in Hitler's army. He said he hoped by writing the book, he could set the record straight. Georg identified as Jewish. He knew and often quoted the fact that Jews adhere to the maternal line, which in his case was unbroken. His family members were treated as second-class citizens, and it was only the fact of his Aryan father's prior war service that kept him and his mother out of the camps. The book, in manuscript form, was passed on to scores of friends and visitors to our B&B in Mexico. Many told us that Georg's story needed telling more widely. We finally agreed, and in July of 2006, 22 years after he wrote the manuscript, we self-published a first edition of it ourselves. Georg lived another 4 months until November. 7 years later, on the exact date of his passing, I was lighting the candles on my Mexican Day of the Dead altar when the phone rang. It was my amazing, indefatigable literary agent, Emmanuel Morgan. I heard her voice for the first time as she said, "I have some news for you." I replied, "It has to be good." Thus I learned that, thanks to Emmanuel, my 30-year dream had come true. Our book was on its way to the world and the readership it deserved. My affection for my editor, Wesley Adams, began with his wholehearted and continuing enthusiasm for Georg's book. I have come to appreciate his perfectionism, but also his willingness to compromise. He is a true gentleman, but best of all, he makes me smile. Could an author be any luckier? Georg Rauch believed that as long as you could laugh at something, its power to harm you was reduced. In his letters home from Russia, he often tried to find the funny side of things in what were, in reality, very unfunny situations. He takes the same approach in these pages, and the result is a unique tale of one clever, multi-talented 19-year-old who rose above his situations, put his many wits to use, and survived to tell it all. Phyllis Rauch. Prologue. Our right hands stiffly raised, we repeated the words of the oath as they were pronounced. And I solemnly swear to defend Führer, Volk, and Vaterland. The morning of February 26, 1943, was bitter cold. Individual ice crystals dropped silently from the leaden, low-lying sky. It was too cold to snow. On a large barracks parade ground just outside Vienna, 600 teenagers stood at attention, three abreast in a long column. We must have looked like oversized tin soldiers placed there for some child's fantasy. Our boot heels were squeezed together, left palms were pressed to the seams of our trousers, chests were puffed out, stomachs sucked in, eyes staring straight ahead. We were smartly outfitted in the parade uniforms of the German Wehrmacht. The German soldier, Prussia's pride and invention, was expected to be tough as leather, hard as Krupp steel, and fleet as a greyhound. But after only 3 weeks of basic training, we weren't exactly the perfect prototypes. I can imagine that had he been there, Hitler wouldn't have been very gratified to catch sight of me, since I definitely didn't conform to his ideal type. I measured only 5 feet 10 inches tall, and my hair was a wild tangle of black curls. My eyes looked green or gray, depending upon the light, and the rest of my features were decidedly non-Aryan. My physique boasted no broad shoulders or other impressive details, though I was slim and well-built for my size. On this particular day, my large and curving nose was also red and runny, and my head was aching under the unaccustomed weight of the heavy iron helmet. My thoughts were no less heavy either. It wasn't one of the happier moments of my young life. The small group of German officers administering the oath stood facing us on the snow-covered ground. Oberstleutnant Kraus, the commanding officer of the communications training section, had just completed his speech, raving about the inevitable victory of the German forces over capitalism and communism. We were all aware that Stalingrad had fallen, and that Allied bombers were making cocky daylight raids on major German cities. I don't believe any of us expected the outcome of the war could be changed by a miracle such as the Wunderwaffe, Hitler's long-promised mystery missile that would ensure Germany's victory. Inevitably, the ever more powerful Allied forces would finally bring Germany to its knees. Oberstleutnant Kraus, evidently having refused to recognize these facts, reminded us of our duty and described in glowing terms how thrilling it would be when we finally got the chance to split a Russian skull with our spades. The military band played Deutschland, Deutschland über alles, and small clouds of steam from the musical instruments drifted skyward. A review company presented arms. As we were repeating the last words of the oath, to defend Führer, Volk, and Vaterland unto the death, I noticed that two of the soldiers ahead of me had the index and middle fingers of their left hands crossed, just the way I did. I hoped that none of the officers were patrolling behind us, recording for future punishment the names of those taking refuge in that ancient childhood trick. We were adolescents, still playing at the game of war. But after just a few more months of training, we would be expected to perform as men, to take the lives of strangers on command, unquestioningly. Part 1. Secrets in the Attic. I shined my boots to a mirror finish and polished my belt buckle. Then I rubbed gasoline on a tiny grease spot I had noticed on my uniform jacket. I was nervous. The other soldiers in the room had no idea of what I intended, why I was making such a fuss over my appearance when we were only scheduled to attend rifle practice on the shooting range.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.